163, Jesus is the sweetest name I know.
The reason why I love.
2 Chronicles chapter 6. I'm going to read a little bit out of chapter 6, and then I'm going to read also chapter 7, verse 1 through 3. But 2 Chronicles chapter 6, verse 12 through 19 is all that I'll read. I'll refer to some other parts of it, but I'm just going to read from verse 12 to 19. Then I'll read chapter 7, verse 1 through 3. Let's stand together. Thank you for honoring God's word. That is a blessing. And we just thank the Lord. We've got his words preserved for us in our hands, in our King James Bible. And it's a great blessing. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So 2 Chronicles chapter 6, start there at verse 12. And he stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the congregation of Israel and spread forth his hands. For Solomon had made a brazen scaffold of 5 cubits long and 5 cubits broad and 3 cubits high, and had set it in the midst of the court. And upon it he stood and kneeled down upon his knees before all the congregation of Israel and spread forth his hands toward heaven and said, O Lord God of Israel, there is no God like thee in the heaven nor in the earth, which keepest covenant and showest mercy unto thy servants that walk before thee with all their hearts. Thou which hast kept with thy servant David my father, that which thou hast promised him, and spakest with thy mouth, and hast fulfilled it with thine hand, as it is this day. Now therefore, O Lord God of Israel, keep with thy servant David my father that which thou hast promised him, saying, There shall not fail thee a man in my sight to sit upon the throne of Israel. Yet so that thy children take heed to their way to walk in my law, as thou hast walked before me. Now then, O Lord God of Israel, let thy word be verified, which thou hast spoken unto thy servant David. But will God in every deed dwell with men on the earth? Behold, heaven and the heaven of heavens cannot contain thee, how much less this house which I have built. Have respect, therefore, to the prayer of thy servant and to his supplication, O Lord my God, to hearken unto the cry and the prayer which thy servant prayeth before thee. And then if you'd go to chapter 7, verse 1 through 3, Now when Solomon had made an end of praying, the fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house. And the priests could not enter into the house of the Lord, because the glory of the Lord had filled the Lord's house. And when all the children of Israel saw how the fire came down and the glory of the Lord upon the house, they bowed themselves with their faces to the ground upon the pavement and worshiped and praised the Lord, saying, For he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Would you bow for a word of prayer again this afternoon? Father, I come, and you know that I don't ever want to weary thee with my prayers and asking for the filling of thy Holy Spirit, the anointing of my lips and mind. You know, Lord, I love my people. These dear ones could have been anywhere else today. They could have gone to some other place, some other church, and yet they chose to be here. And so you've appointed an hour, a message, and an appointed a man in this particular case. But Lord, it'd be all right if you'd just come in, so that as verse 2 that we just read in chapter 7, the priests could not enter into the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord had filled the Lord's house. Lord, it'd be all right if you just worked. You don't need me. But there are people looking in by way of the internet that need to know some things about prayer. There are us that are sitting here, including myself, that need to be reminded of these things about prayer and how important it is. And so, Father, I ask that you'd work in a great way, and that through us, souls would be saved for Jesus' sake and for his glory, and that you would continue to do some things as only you can. And we'll thank you for it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I want you to know that no revival that I've ever read about, and God's had me read a lot of things about revival in a lot of different places around the world. I'm still trying to find the book on the way that God used great revival in Korea with Daniel Goforth. Someday God will let me find that book. I really want to read it. But I've never read about a revival. And I've never seen, because God's also let me see, two real revivals in my ministry. I've never seen that come about except by prayer. It just doesn't happen. Now, I did read about, back in the late 1800s, about revival in a coal mining village there in Wales that seemed to just break out as everyone thought about it. And as people were getting right with God and looking, you know, to God to do some great things, they finally came upon a house of an invalid widow woman who had been praying in her bed for years for revival. Prayer is important. If we're going to have a revival journey, if we're going to have any kind of revival in our own hearts, if we're going to have any kind of revival in our church, if we're going to have any kind of revival in this country or anywhere in the world, it's going to be through prayer. And so I call you to pray, and pray in a special way. This message this afternoon is an examination of how we pray, what we pray for. I'm sure that all of you pray. I mean, that'd be, you know, kind of a ridiculous thing for me to think, well, nobody here in the room prays. I think all of you pray. But I want us to just examine how we pray. Now, Solomon prayed in this passage that we have here, and God moved in such a way that everyone worshiped. I mean, they fell down, they put their faces to the ground upon the pavement, and they worshiped and praised God, saying, "For he is good, for his mercy endureth forever." You know partly why they said his mercy endureth forever? It's because that fire didn't lick up them. The fire came down and it consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, but it didn't burn up them. It could have, and it should have. You know, when we think about it, there's so many times that we have let God down, so many times we've disappointed him, so many times, as I preached this morning, that we've offended God with the sin in our own life. But his mercy endureth forever.
Amen.
And, you know, this is just an incredible thing. Folks, I have been in church services where we're singing, and I don't ever get to preach. Don't need to. I mean, God just moves in. People just start getting their heart right. Things just start happening. You know, that's a great thing. You know, for God to just take over and just, it doesn't have to be by the program, by the bulletin. God can move in, do some things. And that's important for us to understand that we need to be looking for and understanding that God can do some wonderful things. And I'm not talking about some kind of charismatic, you know, something or other that's not real, but I mean God actually coming in. And what we saw here in chapter 7, an incredible kind of thing. But for us to see revival, personal, churchwide, national, we must pray. And pray these ways. Here's the first way. We must pray uninterrupted for a good period each day. We have to pray uninterrupted for a good period each day. I don't know about you, but I only read from verse 12 to verse 19, but the prayer continued on to verse 42. It wasn't a quick, you know, "Now I lay me down to sleep, pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I die before I wake, pray the Lord my soul to take. Amen, thank you, Lord." You know, it wasn't, past the teeth and past the gums, "Look out, tummy, here it comes." I mean, this is a prayer here. I mean, he's praying. And we need to pray. Now, go with me, if you would, to Deuteronomy chapter 26. This is the only point I'm going to do this on. But I want you to see some things here in Deuteronomy chapter 26, verse 7 and 8. Deuteronomy chapter 26, verse 7 and 8. It says this, "And when we cried unto the Lord God of our fathers, the Lord heard our voice and looked on our affliction and our labor and our oppression. And the Lord brought us forth out of Egypt with a mighty hand and with an outstretched arm and with great terribleness and with signs and with wonders." You know, they cried unto the Lord how long? 400 years. They prayed and prayed and prayed. They cried unto the Lord. Go with me now to the book of Psalms, Psalm 3, verse 4, the third psalm, and verse number 4. Psalm 3, 4. If you would. And here's what the psalmist said. David, you know, he's running from Absalom, and he says this, "I cried unto the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill." Selah. I cried unto the Lord. You know, it's not just a quick, hey, Lord, we'd really like revival. Thanks. Bye. You know, I cried unto the Lord. I mean, just cried out to the Lord. Look in Psalm 18 and verse number 6, if you would. Psalm 18, verse 6. In my distress I called upon the Lord and cried unto my God, and he heard my voice out of his temple, and my cry came before him, even into his ears. You know, he cried unto the Lord. You know, an uninterrupted prayer for a good period of the day. Chapter 34, if you would, verse 4, please. Psalm 34 and verse 4. And here it says it this way. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears.
Amen.
I sought the Lord. You know, for this morning's message, I was trying to find a passage, and I never did find it. And I knew that if I said in the morning message, I was trying to find this passage, all of you'd be looking, and the message would go on, and you'd be looking, trying to find it for me. And I appreciate that kind of help, but I didn't want that this morning. But I was looking for passages of Scripture, and I mean, I looked for an hour just for that one verse of Scripture. And I never did find it. I know it's in there. I don't know where. I mean, I've got from Genesis to Revelation to find it, and maybe one day I'll find it again, but the Lord said, nope, you don't need it for this morning's message. I said, okay, after the hour, I said, okay. But I sought for that verse. I mean, I just kept looking and looking. How do we seek the Lord? Do we cry unto him, you know, for God to do some things, revival in our life? You know, 2 or 3 minutes of prayer won't bring God down. And that's what we saw here, you know, that it said that the fire came down in verse 1 of chapter 7. And verse 3 also said, you know, they saw how the fire came down. You're not going to bring God down just 2-3 minutes of prayer. Not going to happen. Nope, won't happen. Go with me to the book of Acts chapter 1, verse number 14. The book of Acts chapter 1. Now, I know that the apostles and all, they're pretty scared. You know, Jesus had been put to death and now he's gone and that kind of thing, but at least here's what we see in Acts chapter 1, verse 14. It says, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. You know, they prayed. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication. And then I look in chapter 2, verse 1 and 2, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. I wonder what they were doing, because chapter 1, verse 14 said, these all continued with one accord. I wonder what they were doing when they were all in one accord in one place. I have the tendency to think they were probably praying. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And then look in chapter 4, verse 31 of Acts. Acts chapter 4, verse 31, it says this, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. It doesn't say, and when they had sung. It doesn't say, and when they had read the Scripture. It doesn't say, and when they had great preaching. It said, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together.
Amen.
And they spake the word of God with boldness. It's a real revival will help us go out and speak the word of God with boldness. Remember, Jesus prayed in the garden. And if you want to take a look there in Matthew chapter 26 and verse 40, he admonished his apostles, his disciples. In Matthew chapter 26 and verse 40, he's in the garden. And you remember here what he said to them. And he cometh unto the disciples, and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, What? Could ye not watch with me 1 hour? See, we have to have uninterrupted prayer for a good period each day. That takes work, folks. That takes a lot of work. And you know, somebody said this, the best way to learn to pray is to show up for practice. I thought that was a good idea. You know, to be good at hitting a baseball, they'll practice for hours and hours and hours every day. If I really wanted to be good with that guitar, I'd practice with that thing hours every day. I mean, I used to for Satan. You know, if you want to be good at praying, you just have to keep at it. Practice. Pray. It's important for us. Are you still in Matthew? Would you look there in chapter 6 of Matthew, verse 5 and 7? 5 through 7, rather. Matthew chapter 6, verse 5 through 7. It says there, And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray, standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. But when ye pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. We need to pray. How important that is. And of course, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17, it tells us there, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. Well, how do you do that? Well, there's all kinds of things, moment by moment, that come up that we need to pray about. And we need to be able to pray without ceasing. Pray about this thing, that thing. We see this happening. I've got this encounter with this person. I better pray. I don't want to be in the flesh. I want to be in the power of the Holy Spirit. I'd better pray. Ask for help in this thing. We need to pray. If we're going to have any kind of a revival, it's going to take some real, real prayer. People used to get together on their lunch hours in New York City, and they'd pray and pray the whole lunch hour. God did some incredible things and some revivals in New York City. That was years ago. They don't do it now. But we need to pray. Here's another thing that we need to pray. We must pray about our relationship with Almighty God. Back here in 2 Chronicles, chapter 6, verse 14 through 17, where I read earlier, we see that Solomon is praying and relating to God through a relationship. In verse 14, and said, O Lord God of Israel, there is no God like thee in the heaven nor in the earth, which keepest covenant and showest mercy to thy servants that walk before thee with all their hearts. Thou which hast kept with thy servant David my father that which thou hast promised him. And he's talking about a relationship here. He's a God that keepeth covenant. We've got a relationship. Don't we have a better covenant, a new covenant in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ? We've got quite a covenant relationship with God. You know, it's a relation. He's now our Father. We've been adopted. You know, we can cry to Him, Abba, Father. You know, a relationship. God, that relationship that we have is important. And, this not a ritual kind of thing. You know, where we're always saying the same kind of things to God. But he's talking here about David and this promise that he's given to David through all these things. You notice there, which verse 16, Now therefore, O Lord God of Israel, keep with thy servant David my father that which thou hast promised him, saying, There shall not fail thee a man in my sight to sit upon the throne of Israel. And there's Solomon saying, Here I am, I'm that next man sitting on the throne. I'm his son, his blood. I'm sitting on the throne just like you promised in that relationship. In verse 17, Now then, O Lord God of Israel, let thy word be verified, which thou hast spoken unto thy servant David. We've got a relationship. Verify it. Make it true. Make it show that we know what that is. And so when we pray to God in a prayer that's going to be something for revival, we need to make sure that we renew that relationship and that we express the love we have for God and review His love for us and His promises to us and His goodness to us. It's important for us to understand that relationship. Look with me, if you would, in the Gospel of Luke, where I preached before. In Luke here, if you will, chapter 10, starting at verse 38. Luke chapter 10, starting at verse 38. We read here, "Now it came to pass, as they went, that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. She had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about much serving, and came to him and said, 'Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me.' And Jesus answered and said unto her, 'Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things, but one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her.'" Mary chose that relationship. Martha was doing the duties, but let that relationship kind of fall by the wayside. Yeah? When we pray, we need to pray about that relationship. Mary was in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. We need to talk to Jesus and let him talk to us through his word. Amen. And it's based on relationship. Can you go with me to 1 John chapter 5, starting at verse 13 through 15? 1 John chapter 5, verse 13 through 15. And it says this, 1 John 5:13, "These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of him." We've got a great promise about God answering prayer, but it's based on a relationship. It's based on the fact that, you know, that we know him and that he knows us and that kind of thing that we have. And that's how we get our confidence, is through the relationship that we have in Jesus Christ. So when we pray for revival, we need to pray about relationship. But here's a third thing that we need to pray. We must pray in a balanced way. We must pray in a balanced way. You notice back here in 2 Chronicles chapter 7 that when Solomon started praying here, at verse 14 is where he actually starts the prayer out of his mouth, that he doesn't pray, asking for things. We have a tendency to start out praying to God, "God, you know our needs, and we have this need and that need. Please, God, meet this and take care of this and do this, and I need this. Yes, Lord, I don't want to be selfish, so take care of this person and that person. Please, Lord, do this and do this and do this for me." That's a tendency we have to pray. All these things we want God to do. But that's not how Solomon prayed, and the fire came down. We need to pray in a balanced way. Let me give you an acrostic. Do you know what that is? I'm going to give you the letters that form a word, but from those letters are going to come words. Okay? And the acrostic is the letters for Acts, just like the book of Acts. They, in the book of Acts, they got together, they prayed, and the place was shaken. Amen? So the book of Acts, here's how we ought to pray. We ought to start out A, adoration. Start out adoring God, praising God, worshiping God, and all these things. He started out here, "O Lord God of Israel, there is no God like thee in the heaven, nor in the earth." You know, I mean, he's just praising God for who he is. Adoration. And God, I love you and I praise you for who you are and I praise you for your work in my life. And I just thank God. You know, we ought to adore God. Adoration is how we ought to start. And then the letter C in the word Acts is the word for contrition. Confession, whichever way you want to write it down. I don't care. Confession or contrition. You know, we have to be thinking about those things. Lord, you're great, but oh boy, about me. Like the Apostle Paul, in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. And we need to be sure that we're confessed up, because if we harbor sin in our life, God's not going to hear us. You know? And if you look here in 2 Chronicles chapter 6 and verse 22, it says there, if a man sin against his neighbor. I mean, that just kind of jumps out at me there. We ought to, you know, we have that kind of thing. And then we see there in verse 24, and if thy people Israel be put to worse before the enemy because they have sinned against thee. I mean, he talks about that kind of thing. Lord, if my life has not been pleasing to you, I want to confess it right now. If this or that, this thing, that thing, Lord, forgive me for this. Yeah, we need to do that. A-C-T. Thanksgiving. We ought to be thankful to God. When we pray, if we're going to have any kind of revival, we need to pray with great thanksgiving. You know, we can start thanking God that He's given us life. Thank God that He's given us His words, which are life. Thank God that He opened our eyes so we could see the truth of the Word, that Jesus Christ is the Savior that He says He is. Thank God that He saved me. He didn't have to, but He did. Amen. I praise Him for that. I mean, we just start thanking God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. There was a man in one church, and he was having all kinds of troubles and all that kind of thing. And he said, God doesn't seem to ever get through to me. And the pastor said, this is what I want you to do. For the whole week, I want you to do nothing. Absolutely ask God for nothing. Just thank Him for the whole week. Just go home and just thank Him. Just do that. Don't ask Him for anything. Just thank Him. Changed his life. You know, we need to thank God. But so many times all we do is, God, give me, give me, give me, give me. I need this. Give it to me. Give it to me. We don't thank God. Then S, the last of the word acts, is supplication, where we actually do ask God for something. You see, too often we think of God as just a bellhop, just a servant. You know, we ring the bell and God does this for us. Just a servant. And you know, He's the Almighty God. And that's important for us to remember about God, that He's a great and mighty God. And we need to pray in a balanced way, you know, with thanksgiving. And you notice that even Solomon prayed those ways, you know, about being thankful to God. And that's important. Well, here's a fourth way that we must pray. If we're going to have any kind of revival, we must pray centered on holiness. Centered on holiness. I alluded to it already here, but you notice that Solomon, when he did pray, he did mention the fact that people of Israel sin. If any man sin, that kind of thing. He did pray those ways. You know, when all we do is go to God and ask for wealth and health and those sort of things. I mean, yeah, a lot of times those are needs. I won't downplay that, diminish that in any way. You know, we do ask God for our needs. The Word of God says He supplies all of our needs, you know, we're supposed to. But a lot of times we forget to pray and ask God, make me holy. I mean, God said, be ye holy, for I am holy, thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
But we don't pray, God, make me holy. Help me to be holy. Show me how to be holy. Have you ever thought about praying through the Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 5? You know, I mean, that might be a good place to start there. You know, starting at verse 3, Matthew chapter 5, verse 3, down through verse 11, it says there, blessed are the poor in spirit. Lord, make me poor in spirit. Make me understand that it's not me, it's not my charisma, it's not my looks, it's not my heritage, it's not my anything my. You know, Lord, make me poor in spirit. How about verse 4, blessed are they that mourn. Lord, make me mourn. Mourn over sin in my own life. Mourn over sin in my country. Mourn over sin maybe in my church, I don't know. Lord, make me mourn over the things that make you mourn. How about praying, Lord, make me meek, verse 5. Blessed are the meek. Yeah. No, Lord, make me bold, make me a success, make me famous, make me... No, Lord, make me meek. That it's not about me. It's about the Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 6, Lord, make me hunger and thirst after righteousness. You know, do we pray that way? No, Lord, give me this. Lord, fix the flat tire on my car. Lord, you know, fix this, fix that. You know, well, I'm not going to be selfish. So, Lord, fix the heat in Emmanuel's apartment so that he won't be cold tonight. Yeah. We ought to pray if we're going to have any kind of revival. Lord, help me to hunger and thirst after righteousness. Lord, help me, verse 7, to be merciful. Lord, there's all kinds of people come around me that, you know, they need to be shown mercy. Yeah, I've got a right to do this and that to them, but I need to show mercy to them. Just, my neighbor's dogs still use my yard for a bathroom. I can't seem to stop them. I don't know. I'm thinking of seeing if I can buy through the internet some of the Berlin Wall and put that up, you know, the barbed wire at the top. And, yeah.
I'll go in with you.
Amen. Oh, you know what things I have thought to do with what I have scooped up? Oh, but I said they need mercy. They're never going to come to know Christ as Savior if I get all upset with them and everything. Mercy. You pray, Lord, let me be pure in heart. Do you pray, Lord, let me be a peacemaker? Lord, let me react to persecution the way Jesus reacted. He was reviled and reviled not. You know, that's a good way to pray, don't you think?
Amen.
That might be some way to pray. Then maybe we ought to also pray here in Romans chapter 8 and verse 29. Romans chapter 8, verse 29, it says, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate. And I'm not going to get into all of that this afternoon. It says, to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. And I've taught you this before. I don't mind teaching it again to you. But conformed is, here is a mold, and we're going to press something into it. We're going to conform whatever this is to this mold. We're going to press it in. God's trying to press you and I into the mold of the Lord Jesus Christ. But do we pray, Lord, conform me to the image of the Lord Jesus Christ? You know, we ought to pray that way. Hey, how about praying Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22 and 23? Have you ever thought about praying that way? Lord, please form in me the fruit of the Spirit of love. And remember, the fruit of the Spirit doesn't come about when we have these things going on. The fruit of the Spirit, like, you know, Lord, help me to love when that person's not lovely. Lord, help me to have joy when everything's going wrong. when I've got only disappointment, when I've got only heartache in my life. Help me to have joy. Lord, help me to have peace when everything is confusing, everything is on me. Lord, help me to have long suffering when I've got that person, as I preached about this morning, that seven times in a day has offended me. Lord, help me to have gentleness when I want to be just as stern and ugly. Lord, help me to have goodness when I don't want to be good. Help me to have faith when Lord, oh, I can't see it. I need faith. Help me to have meekness. Help me to have temperance. Keep my body in control, as the Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians there. You know, maybe we ought to be praying Colossians chapter 3, verse 4 through 14. We ought to be praying there in Colossians chapter 3, verse 14, 4 through 14, where it says, "When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth." Lord, put to death my members. Here they are: fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Yeah, you and I can have any of those things, and we need to put them to death. "For which things' sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience, in the which ye also walked some time when ye lived in them. But now ye also put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, also do ye. And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness." You ever thought about praying, "Lord, help me to put off the old man and put on the new man, which is created in Christ Jesus. Help me to put off these things that are listed here that are negative and put on the things that are listed here as good things. Lord, help me to put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness." See, our prayer life ought to be centered on holiness. Yeah, I know. There's that ache and pain that you have that you really would like to have put away. But the Apostle Paul said, you know, that he pressed toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. He only prayed thrice, he said, that whatever that infirmity was that he had went away. But I bet he prayed every day that he'd be conformed to the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. Here's the last thing that we must pray. We must pray focused on evangelism. We must pray focused on evangelism. We looked at Solomon's prayer. Take a look back there in 2 Chronicles chapter 6, if you would, and look there with me at verse 32 and 33. 2 Chronicles chapter 6, verse 32 and 33, here's what we read. "Moreover, concerning the stranger, which is not of thy people Israel, but is come from a far country for thy great name's sake and thy mighty hand," and "thy stretched out arm, if they come and pray in this house, then hear thou from the heavens, even from thy dwelling place, and do according to all that the stranger calleth to thee for, that all people of the earth may know thy name and fear thee as doth thy people Israel, and may know that this house which I have built is called by thy name." He's talking about missions right there. That all the earth would know. This person from a far country comes and sees what God is doing, sees that glory of God in that temple that he's built there, and they go back to their far country and tell all about what God's done. Again, we often are selfish in prayer. We pray, me, mine, my. But what about they, as in they that are lost, they that are without Christ? Dear ones, missions is the heartbeat of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when we pray, if we want God's revival, if we want the fire to come down, if we want the house to be so filled with the glory of God that we can't do anything but just worship God, if we want real revival, we need to be focused on evangelism as we pray. We need to pray for individuals that we know. That's important. We also need to pray for national groups of people. Did you ever think about getting a map? And maybe take the map and pray about it, but take the map and draw some lines, if you will, so that you can pray the 7 days for 7 different areas. Why isn't the world divided up into 7 continents? Just pray over each of those continents one a day. Pray for those kind of people. You know, when we were in Bible college, they had what they called a missionary prayer society. And anybody could be part of it. You didn't have to be going into missions, didn't have to be in the missions program at the Bible college. Anybody could go. And they would just, every week, they'd just focus on a country. They'd just pray. All those people would be praying. If it was the country of France, they'd all be on their knees praying for the French people to come to know Jesus Christ as Savior. Then they'd take another country. Maybe it would be Brazil, and they'd pray for them and the missionaries that are working there. They'd pray for that kind of thing. God does some great things when we pray that way. You know, we ought to pray for pastors and evangelists and missionaries that they would win people to Christ, that there'd be those people ready for trusting Christ as their Savior. And pray that way. God's going to ever work in revival in your own heart. If God's ever going to work in revival in this church, in the United States of America, in this world, anywhere, it's going to be because of prayer. Amen. When we look there in James chapter 5, verse 16 and 17, if you would, just, this is it. Last place, I'm going to read these verses. We're done. Book of James, chapter 5, verse 16 and 17. Says this: confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are. And he prayed earnestly that it might not rain. And it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. What I wanted us to see is the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And then there was Elijah. And Elijah prayed after all those priests of Baal cut themselves and cried out and put their blood all over the sacrifices and all that, and Elijah just prayed a simple prayer, and the fire came down. Licked up not only the sacrifice, but all the wood and all the water that was around it. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man or a righteous woman availeth much. I started out by asking you to examine your prayer life. Not whether you pray or not, I believe you do. But if we're going to pray and have God work in revival, we're going to have to pray in these ways. Let's bow together. Father, thank you again that your word is what we need to understand. And Lord, as we pray, would it be such that the place would be shaken, that your glory would fill this room, that all we could do is worship you and thank you that your mercy endures forever, but that we'd get up all from our knees and go out and speak the word with boldness, that others had come to know Jesus as Savior. Lord, oh, how we thank you. I started these messages on revival before Brother Hardman came. I've continued on with them because you've prompted me to do so. Lord, it's not Brother Hardman, and it's not me, but the effectual, fervent prayer of these righteous people that are before me will bring heaven down in such powerful ways that we have no idea what you're going to do. Lord, please, Ithaca, Tompkins County, all these students that are here for the colleges, they need to see something real from heaven. They need to see us bold for you. And so please, Lord, continue to work in our lives and help us. Lord, we do pray that there'd be lost people saved, that even through the internet ministry that we have, they would come to know Jesus Christ as Savior, and that it would reach out all around the world. So we love you. We thank you for your blessings. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, my dear ones. Lord bless you and pray. Amen. Pray. Amen.